Professor Hagen, you're not Danish. You're usually from Germany, but you live in Denmark now.
Sure.
And you know the situation in Denmark very well. All what we hear is you have a lot of wind energy there, you have a lot of renewables there, and you plan to be fossil fuel free by 2050.
Yes, everybody who sails from Germany to Denmark will first notice the big wind farms in the Baltic Sea. In the last year, in fact, they provided about 50% of the electricity in Denmark. This is quite an important milestone on the road towards a fossil-free society, which is the ambition of the politicians to be reached in 2050. And apart from the wind, I think Denmark, or when you look in the wind industry, Denmark is one of the leading countries in the world. And they are even expanding the existing facilities even more. Also in Germany, it is the same. And you know, when the wind is blowing, it's blowing in the whole area. And sometimes it's not blowing. Still, we need electricity, we need fuels at the times where we want to have it. So the extension of more and more wind or solar, other renewable sources, poses some challenges to match the consumption with the production. This calls for efficient conversion technologies, storage technologies, and that is actually the topic that our department is dedicated to.
Power to gas is a big issue in Denmark.
Maybe even more in Germany, but in all these countries where you get more and more electricity from renewable sources, you have to find a way how to store this electricity. Right now, we talk a lot about electricity. In the future, when we want to be fossil-free, we also need to talk about transport. This is 25 or even more percent of the energy consumption. So power to X, power to gas is a big challenge. And here, the technologies I'm working with, solid oxide technologies, come into play because they are capable of precisely doing that.
And in Denmark, different from Germany, also look at the heating sector, and you probably have no power plant and no plant at all without the heating exchange system. So combined heat and power is also a big issue in Denmark.
Yes, most of the big power plants, if they are fired by coal or biomass or waste, they are all usually combined heat and power. So they run on a very high overall efficiency. The heat is used and distributed in the central heating. So in that way, the whole energy system is quite advanced and has to be converted from the fossil base, which is the case now, to a base fossil-free production of electricity. And here, in fact, the solid oxide fuel cells, the high-temperature fuel cells, come into play because they can precisely provide heat and electricity.
That's the big advantage of solid oxide technology. It's a high temperature, and high temperature does not mean 100 or 150 degrees, but 700, 800 degrees. They run at really high temperatures.
Yeah, this is correct. So that's why they're called high temperature technologies. And what comes with that operation mode is that they are capable of utilizing not only hydrogen as a fuel, but also carbon-containing fuels. We can use natural gas, we can use biogas, even with a very cost-competitive pretreatment, also a diesel or gasoline, the fuels we have available right now, because the fuel cell can convert these hydrocarbons in a mixture that can be converted to electricity. So we don't need to throw away carbon, which is in a fuel. We can use carbon-containing and hydrogen-containing fuels.
There's always sort of discussion between the purists and those who love the technology. Those who love the technology want to implement it, fuel cell technology, and use the existing infrastructure. And that you can do with solid oxide fuel cells or electrolyzers. But some people say, no, we only need the pure righteousness and go only for pure hydrogen. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, this is my, let's say, humble opinion as a scientist, as a researcher. For me, it's difficult to envisage that we can solve all challenges and investments for hydrogen, establishment of the infrastructure, establishment of the fuel cell technology, the storage, the distribution, and so forth. For me, it sounds very attractive to have a solution which is also capable of utilizing existing infrastructure. In fact, Europe is closely covered by a network for transporting natural gas. Already now we can accommodate at least 50% of energy from renewable sources in the existing natural gas infrastructure. This is a huge investment that has been done in the past, which we now can utilize directly for solid oxide fuel cells. We can feed natural gas and achieve electrical efficiencies around 60%.
Which is pretty good, indeed.
Yes, and we can run the reverse mode, the electrolysis mode, in fact, feeding or converting electricity from, for example, wind into a gas mixture and methane and add this to the natural gas network. So we have already a good storage network. In the future, this can be also used in conjunction with biogas instead of natural gas or other kind of carbon-containing sources or networks, liquid petroleum gas or CNG and so forth.
You just mentioned they are reversible, and there was a large discussion on reversible fuel cells, and people say, well, you can only optimize it the one way or the other. What about solid oxide technology? Is it always very efficient on the fuel cell side as well as on the electrolyzer side?
Yeah, I think it's the only technology among fuel cell electrolysis where you can run the same core, the stack, in both directions as a fuel cell or an electrolysis cell. Fuel cells, I mentioned, you achieve electrical efficiencies around 60%. The electrolysis, only the electrolysis step can reach efficiencies of 100% due to the operating mode at the high temperature, gives you the opportunity to achieve these high efficiencies. And you can actually operate the same materials in both directions, which might be an advantage to balance the input from fluctuating renewable sources and also to make it possible to store electricity and reuse it later on when it is needed. So this is a kind of unmatched feature that these high temperature cells have.
So solid oxide technology would be very good for grid balancing. Because on the one hand, if you have too many renewables, you don't have to switch it off like we do in Schleswig-Holstein in Germany, but use it for in electrolyzers, in solid oxide electrolyzers, to produce hydrogen for it, store it, and then if you need energy again, put it back to the grid with the same devices.
This is correct. So this is a very attractive feature. And here, the balancing, we talk about like the minute scale, so you can run dynamically fuel and electrolyzer stack in the range of minutes where you can adjust. If you need faster balancing, you should need intermediate technologies. And in addition, the storage capacity, we talk here about from minutes to months, weeks and months, because the gas is a very good storage medium or even liquid. So this is really a medium you can store over a long term and also in large volumes.
But Professor Hagen, as you said, it's this high temperature technology, and to bring it on temperature that it needs for usage, it takes some time. So they can never be as dynamic as PEMs are.
They can be dynamic as long as they are at the operating temperature. The heat up as such will require some more time, clearly, than the PEM fuel cells. If you run on stationary units, this is not a big problem because then those you would not turn on off quite often, so you can idle them or go to a very low usage if you don't need electricity, for example. On the other hand, there are also...
You keep the temperature then in between.
Yeah. You can keep the temperature. On the other hand, when you want to have a very fast response, you can also develop specific materials and technologies that are capable of a faster heating within a few minutes or 15 minutes. Clearly, it cannot be seconds or so, but then it is very attractive to combine with, for example, electrical batteries in a vehicle where you have a very fast response, and then you can use for high efficiency and efficient usage of fuel, you can use the fuel cell.
So let's talk a little bit about applications. I could imagine stationary fuel cells, large stationary fuel cells, let's say for a company that needs energy and heating, like we see with Bloom Energy in California. These are made also from solid oxide fuel cells, aren't they?
Yeah, this is correct. So one of the companies that sells this technology is Bloom Energy in the US. So when on the homepage, you can recognize a lot of customers, NASA, Google,
well-known
eBay.
Customers,
yeah,
indeed.
No,
yes,
we don't want to make advertisement. Yes, and this is actually a market segment we are looking at as well as a researcher. And here for us, it is quite interesting to utilize the fuel flexibility. For example, we are interested in using biogas as a fuel for the fuel cell. And biogas is very attractive also in the future when we don't have fossil fuels any longer. Biogas you can obtain from wastewater treatment or from landfill, so from waste, organic waste. And this biogas is in fact very thin and you cannot utilize the energy in combustion engines any longer. However, in a fuel cell, you are still able to convert this energy content into electricity with a high efficiency. So here we have the focus on the type of fuel and what are the challenges connected to that. Another quite interesting fuel which has re-emerged is ammonia. And you might wonder ammonia, why? But ammonia is one of the world's largest chemicals used for fertilizer production. It has
What kind of industry is this needed, especially fertilizer production, yes?
Yes, so it has a long-standing 100-year track record in logistics infrastructure. Why ammonia? So ammonia you can use as a hydrogen carrier with very attractive storage properties and energy density. So you can, in the case of our fuel cell technology, you can directly feed ammonia and run a fuel cell on ammonia. It's the same as if you would feed hydrogen.
But also the other way around, probably. If you have a solid oxide electrolyzer, you can produce ammonia, you can produce fertilizer, green fertilizer. This is a new application, really.
Yes, so while you want to substitute fossil fuels, it is clearly needed in the future that we have fertilizers to feed the humans on the planet. And all this is based on ammonia, which needs hydrogen for production. And the hydrogen now comes from methane or natural gas. And in the future, it could be produced via high-temperature electrolysis using steam. So
Professor Hagen, what about landfill gas? Can solid oxide fuel cells also take landfill gas? We have quite a few of it, and there's no use for it, actually.
Yeah, it appears actually quite attractive. Landfill is one type of biogas formed from waste. And here in Europe, our waste locations, they are all isolated. So the biogas landfill cannot slip into the atmosphere. It's a very strong greenhouse gas. And it also contains a lot of nitrogen diluent, which makes it not very attractive for combustion, but for fuel cell, you can use it. And the potential in Asian countries is even bigger.
I would like to open our discussion here to you. If you have any questions, just raise your hand. I'll be with the microphone right with you. Well, I still have some questions, Professor Hagen, because we've been talking about the stationary applications. You can also think about micro CHP, like having a little fuel cell in my house and get my own electricity, my own heating. This is also possible with solid oxide fuel cells, and there are already companies doing that.
Yeah, that is correct. And here, a big demonstration project in Europe is currently running, the PACE project, where we are a partner. This is based on feeding natural gas into the unit for households. And like in Bloom Energy, SOFC technology is very versatile and modular. So it has a high efficiency also at smaller scale, from a few hundred kilowatt up to a megawatt size. This is one of the advantages, that it's like not connected to a certain volume or size, so it is modular in building up. Maybe coming back to the electrolysis mode, here we shortly mentioned power to X or power to gas. X is often mentioned, and what is X standing for? It stands for all kind of chemicals, liquids. In the future, we also need some chemicals or transport fuels, maybe for heavy transport, and that can be made through this power to X technology. You use the electrolyzer. You can electrolyze steam to obtain hydrogen. You can also electrolyze carbon dioxide, and you obtain carbon monoxide. And if you mix hydrogen and carbon monoxide, it's a very well-known technology, you can build up other hydrocarbons, liquids, gasoline, you can build
any
up
kind
chemicals.
Of e-fuels you can produce with that, directly, yes. Uh-huh.
Yes.
Okay, big opportunities. You showed your expertise, Professor Hagen, as well, of course, in this technology, solid oxide technology. Let's talk a little bit about DTU Energy and the service that you offer to your customers.
Yeah, of course, we are a university and not a company. And we see the challenges that we face today with the new energy systems where we want to remove the fossil fuels, and we try to find attractive solutions. And in the frame of solid oxide cells, we have quite a large manpower devoted, about 35 man years. We work, of course, on more fundamental questions. We develop materials. We develop new electrodes that are more robust, cheaper than the currently used ones. We also develop stacks, and a stack is, so to speak, the heart of the technology. That is where the whole, all the processes generating electricity, heat, and vice versa happen. And here we are the experts in evaluating what is going well on the cells and stacks on a very detailed level. We can sometimes even connect a performance, a durability to a certain interface, to a microstructure. This is our strength, that we can understand why a stack, a cell is behaving as they do, and we try to then give a feedback how these properties can be improved to arrive at a cheaper, more robust, more durable technology. We also look more on the theoretical level how these conversion technologies can be implemented with the best benefit into systems. And we also finally offer some commercial services, because we know the industry behind it is not a very big industry, and they might need might to take advantage of our competences and equipment. So if a company needs testing of materials, corrosion testing or fuel cell testing, we can offer this. Also development projects on a bilateral basis we can offer.
It's a really well-equipped fuel cell and hydrogen test center, what you have.
Yes.
There in Roskilde.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Maybe last question to the transport applications, because
yes.
Yesterday I had Bart Biebuyck here, a fuel cell and hydrogen joint undertaking, who said, well, I doubt that it's possible to have propulsion with solid oxide fuel cells. You probably think differently about that, don't you?
Yes, yeah, sure. We have some, we believe, good ideas. In the past, it has been demonstrated that you can use solid oxide fuel cells as an auxiliary power unit in trucks. What is an auxiliary power unit? That delivers electricity if the truck needs cooling, microwave oven, television, when the driver has a break. And these can run on diesel. You have a small, a cost-competitive pre-treatment step, and then you can use the diesel, not in the combustion engine, but in the fuel cell, for emission-free, no NOx is emitted, and high electrical efficiency to provide electricity. And that can actually also be used in vehicles. You could combine with a battery, and then the fuel cell acts as a range extender, where you can extend the ranges to what we want to have, not just 100 kilometers, but what we are used to, 506 kilometers. And with an SOFC, you are able to tank with a fuel with an existing infrastructure. You don't need a tight coverage with hydrogen fuel.
Refueling stations,
you
yes.
can use LPG, NPG. So you combine the best of all worlds. We would say short tanking or fueling times with existing infrastructure, and otherwise with the advantages, features of an electrical vehicle.
Thank you, Professor Hagen, for giving us such a deep insight into that promising technology, solid oxide fuel cell and electrolyzers. Thank you very much for the talk with you. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your attention. You can find the booth of DTU just down there. It's E651, just to the south this direction. Thank you once again.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Attention.